Hey everybody, it's Lon.TV, and we're taking a look today at an affordable 2-in-1 from Acer. This is their Spin 1, and by 2-in-1, I mean it's a laptop that can go into display mode like this, or you can even fold it down into a tablet form factor if you want. It's running Windows 10. It's got an Intel Apollo Lake processor built in, the N3350. And it costs about $310, and that includes a stylus that you can use to write on the screen. We're going to be taking a full look at this laptop here in just a second, but I do want to let you know, in the interest of full disclosure, that this came in on loan from Acer. So when we're done with this, it goes back to them. All of the opinions you're about to hear are my own. Nobody is paying for this review, and no one has approved what you're about to see before I uploaded it. So let's get into it now and see what this computer is all about. So let's take a closer look now at the hardware. There's a lot of things to like about this computer and some things not to like about it. You've got an 11.6-inch display here. It's 1080p, and it's also IPS, meaning you've got decent viewing angles on it and very sharp images. So I'm very pleased with how the display looks here. And one of the things that Acer has been doing lately is putting these nice displays on their lower end laptops and Chromebooks. It's got an Apollo Lake N3350 processor. That's a dual core processor. It is fanless, so it's completely silent when it's operating. 4 gigabytes of DDR3 RAM. And unfortunately, and you can see the low disk space image popping up here, it only has 32 gigabytes of storage. And I was hoping you might be able to upgrade it, so I took it apart. And when I did, I noticed it does have a spot for an M2 size drive inside of it, but they did not include the connector for it. So maybe if you know how to solder things in, you might be able to solder it down on the motherboard and maybe get some expanded storage. But that's a lot of effort to get more storage on here. So you are locked in with the RAM and the storage on this one, and I don't believe there is any way to upgrade it. And 32 gigabytes on Windows is really not manageable anymore. Which is very unfortunate. So that's going to limit how much you can put on the device. But there might be some ways to mitigate that slightly, but not ideal ways to mitigate it. Now, the weight on this one is 2.76 pounds or 1.25 kilograms. I like the build quality quite a bit. It is all metal, top and bottom, so it's got a nice feel to it. The hinge isn't bad. It does flop around slightly here, as you can see, but you do have a lot of flexibility as to where you want to put the display for the best angle. I did notice sometimes, though, when it was in tablet mode here, that it sometimes liked to kind of pop up a little bit. There's a lot of play in the display here when you are in that tablet configuration. Not bad, but a little less tight than I would like it to in that particular spot. So one little note there. But again, you're paying $310 for this. I'm not setting terribly high expectations for it. I'm not all that crazy about the keyboard, though. It types fine. It's got decent travel to it. But the keys are a little smaller than I would like. Typically on Acer devices, their keys, especially on the smaller laptops, tend to run a little smaller. So that was my only big gripe against it. We looked at the Lenovo Flex 6 a few weeks ago. That was about the same size, same similar price category, that had slightly better keys than this one has. But if you don't mind smaller keys, I think you'll be fine there. No issues with the trackpad. It seemed to be tracking just fine as I was using everything. And of course, you also have touch as an option here too, because it is a 2-in-1 tablet device. So you have that available to you there. On the ports here, we don't have too many to talk about, but a few. Power goes in here. You've got an HDMI output here for connecting external displays. USB 3 goes here, and that storage mitigation might happen right here with the micro SD card slot. So you could slide in a card here and store movies and programs and stuff on that if your apps support it, but not all apps do. So just bear that in mind, but you do have some limited options for expanding the storage with a SD card. Volume rocker here, power button is here. You got your headphone microphone combo jack there and a USB 2.0 slot there. And there are stereo speakers on either side of the computer here. So you do get decent stereo separation, but the sound is very tinny. So I think if you are looking for better quality audio, plug in a pair of headphones or something, because you're not going to get great sound out of the speakers on the side here. Now, battery life on this one comes in around 8 to 9 hours in our testing. That means doing word processing and web browsing and some other basic tasks. You, of course, will see less battery life if you're gaming or doing things that might tax the processor a bit further. But generally, those kind of light tasks are what this machine is designed for. So I think it's reasonable that you'll get about a workday of battery life out of it while you're out in the field. And overall, it's pretty good for its price point here. So let's take a look now and see how it performs. We'll begin looking at my YouTube channel with a 1080p 60 frames per second video. That played back just fine on here. We didn't see anything that was a showstopper. One thing you should note though is that if you notice you're getting dropped frames using the Chrome browser, switch over to Microsoft Edge. It is better optimized for YouTube video on these lower end machines. We've been talking about this for a couple of years now. It hasn't gotten better in Chrome just yet, so switch over to that if you are experiencing any kind of video playback issues on YouTube. Other video services should play fine on here, and many already have now a dedicated Windows Store app for those sorts of things. We also ran just a basic web page. We went to nasa.gov and everything rendered on there just fine. It does have wireless AC and Bluetooth built in, and everything from the network standpoint seemed to work fairly well on the device here. Now, we also ran the BrowserBench.org speedometer test, and there we got a score of 36 using the version 1.0 of that test. We compared that to the Lenovo Flex 6 that did a little bit better on that test, which had a more recent Gemini Lake processor. It's basically the next version of the chip that's in this one. The Apollo Lake that's inside the Spin 1 here is from last year, but not a huge jump in performance between the two computers, and overall we were seeing it coming in about where we expected it to for a fanless device like this. I did get a score of 23.6 on the version 2 of that test. We'll be transitioning our scores over to version 2 as we get more samples in to have better comparatives on that. And Microsoft Word ran just fine on here with that newsletter template we always like to look at. Pretty decent performance on that front. And the active stylus here is pretty nice too, given that it's the pack-in device. It does take a battery, a AAA battery on the top. And what will happen with this is that when it gets close to the screen, it will ignore any other touches on screen, so you can write on there and rest your wrist on the screen without it getting picked up. However, we noticed that if you did not get that pen down first, it often would get confused. So the thing we found worked the best would be to get the pen down on screen and then rest your wrist to start writing. Otherwise, it might start doing some crazy stuff. But generally, for a low-cost PC, the wrist detection on here was pretty good. So let's shift gears to gaming now. We've got Minecraft running at about 15 to 25 frames per second at 1080p with the Optifine Performance Enhancing plugin installed. My suggestion would be to run this maybe at 720p to get better performance. This is the Java version of Minecraft. And Rocket League, at its lowest possible settings at 720p, only got about 18 to 25 frames per second, so we're not quite there yet for Rocket League on these cheap fanless laptops, but it's getting there. Half-Life 2, though, ran better. 1080p at low settings was getting about 35 to 45 frames per second. We saw better frame rates when we got into the less complex scenes. And again, this is another spot where if you turn the resolution down to 720p, you might do a little bit better. So these things really are not gaming machines per se, but you can run some low-end games on them. And of course, a lot of the casual games you might find in the Windows Store should work, provided you have enough storage space to support all those games you might want to install on it. We did run the 3D Mark Cloudgate test just to see on paper how this might stack up to other computers. And there we got a score of 2,285. And the graphics performance was pretty good, especially compared to the Flex 6. It did a little better than the next generation chip, and it could just be how everyone is tuning their processors to work in this fanless environment. None of these things are going to be all that great again for gaming, but you can at least see how this one stacks up to other similar computers at around its price point. We also ran the 3D Mark stress test to see how well it does under load over a longer period of time. What happens with fanless laptops is that because they have no way of getting rid of the hot air, they start to run slower the more that they are taxed. And there, on that test, we got a score of 89.7%, which is a failing grade. 97% is a passing score. Most of these laptops do fail that test, but I think generally if you're doing, again, word processing, email, and web browsing, the kinds of things this machine is designed for, you shouldn't see any performance slowdowns normally, but if you are playing a game, you might see those games start to perform poorly as the computer heats up. And we ran Kodi with the 4K Jellyfish test file that we like to look at. This is an HEVC file, 140 megabits per second, 10-bit, and all played back just fine. These Apollo Lake processors can decode that higher-end video in hardware. So in addition to all the streaming services, if you've got some really high bitrate video. It should play back that stuff just fine as well, so good stuff there. And we also booted up Ubuntu 18.04 on here. Networking, display, and sound all worked properly on it. We were able to use the touchscreen for some limited mouse functionality as well. But the only issue we ran into was that the display orientation was not correct. So when it was landscape, it was putting it into portrait mode and vice versa. So I had to flip the laptop over and lock the screen and then flip it back down again for it to detect things properly. So it was kind of reversed in its detection of the screen orientation. So you can work around it, but it wasn't perfect at boot, but everything else worked okay on here. So altogether, I think it's a very nicely priced laptop. You've got a nice display, decent functionality. The performance is about where I would expect it to be for what it has inside. And of course, you get the stylus packed in the box too. So that's a good deal. My biggest gripe though is the fact that you can't upgrade the storage on your own even if you wanted to. And I think that is the most significant limitation here. They've got a bunch of different configurations to choose from though. So if you're willing to spend more, you can get more storage in there. But it was really easy to pop off the bottom panel here. And it would have been nice to have an easier path to upgrading the storage if you choose to do so in the future, because 32 gigabytes right now for Windows 10 just is no longer functional for most people. So great machine, but I think you might want to opt for the higher storage version and pay a little bit more if you liked what you saw here. Until next time, this is Lon Seibin. Thanks for watching.
This channel is brought to you by the Lon.TV supporters, including gold level supporters Chris Allegretta, Tom Albrecht, Bill Reiner, and Kalyan Kumar. If you want to help the channel, you can by contributing as little as a dollar a month. Head over to lon.tv/support to learn more. And don't forget to subscribe. Visit lon.tv/s.